Ding, 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 grab your partners, here we go. Get on your horse and do-si-do. Swing it to the left and swing it to the right. The locker room is here tonight. Yahoo, everybody! It's Channel 31, it's Tuesday night's locker room. It's old Sheriff Greg and Deputy Doug bringing you a special guest we gonna see after the break. Sit a spell. Enjoy yourselves. Welcome back, good folks at home. Welcome to Locker Rooms on a Tuesday night. You can't get rid of this, even if you turn off the television. We'll still be going in the background. It's Greg Blake and Doug Hodgson. We've got a very special guest coming up. Looking forward to speaking to him. Before I do that, thank you so much, Port Wogboy, and all the listeners and the watchers on Channel 31 on a Tuesday night. 30,000 viewers on Channel 31. You are rock stars. Thank you to all the contributors as well on Facebook. We have a lot of fun looking up the Facebook page. And it behooves me to say that we pride ourselves on we've had some exquisite talent from the past. We couldn't find any tonight, so instead we got Chris Taylor, who's the current coach of South Melbourne. And I lie, because he's actually a bit of a ledge way back in the day in the old SNL. Chrissy, welcome to the locker room. How are you, brother?
Fantastic. Good to see you again.
And you do not look a day over your playing days, like in the 80s. You look sensational. Doug, I'd love to say the same for you. How are you?
How are you, Blake? These shirts are starting to fit. Did you not notice that the big fella's losing a bit? I won't be far from me playing. Any chance of a game at South Melbourne this year, CT?
No, but you could be our script writer. But after seeing some of your,
scripts
some of your comments,
we could be okay.
So, you two are BFF, really. You have like pillow fights and stay up and talk about boys all night. I know you've got a lot of stuff going on in your lives. But Chrissy, I just want to quickly, because we talked about it beforehand, and we do love to reminisce about the grand old days. And your career in the NSL was primarily at one of the great clubs in Victorian history, of course, Sunshine George Cross.
Yeah, I mean, a fantastic time, passionate supporters and, dare I say it, at the moment it's probably one of the things that, the A-League's come on in leaps and bounds and they've got the supporters in that, but there were some passionate supporters in them days, some big derbies and battles, Heidelberg, South Melbourne, George Cross, Green Gully.
Green Gully and Sunshine George Cross would be the biggest there, Chris.
Some very entertaining games and some fantastic players in them.
And I was going to say that too. I was just thinking in my head, Sunshine George Cross was really a production room for some tremendous talent. Paul Trimboli and other people, and Kevin Muscat, and all these sort of players came through, and Lawrence Kidner, and all these sort of players came through the George Cross system.
Yeah. I mean, there were some fantastic boys. I mean, probably the best player I've ever played with was John Markowski. And at 15... I don't think we've ever produced a talent like that, and probably a bit disappointed he didn't go on and do some of the bigger things that he could have done. But Andrew Marth was another one that we had down there. Kidner, as you say, Frank Tellier.
Trimboli was there. Paul was there.
As a 17-year-old. Yep. So some fantastic talent came through that club. And, a lot of that credit goes to John Gardner, who was the coach at the time. Yep. And, it was a great time to be playing, and we were pretty much an underdog side all the time. But I remember people like Marshall Soper coming down to Chaplin Reserve and just not wanting to play down there.
It was an ugly place to play.
It still is.
I'm just curious, Chris, because you did mention that George Cross was a perennial underdog, particularly when it was playing in the NSL. So in your period as a player, what was the high point? At which point did Sunshine George Cross reach its highest part of the arc in terms of success? What do you remember the most?
Well, I mean, it's hard to... How do you distinguish success? I mean, I think we finished fourth in the league one year when it was the split zones, the southern and northern. So, that was a fair achievement in itself. But I think the quality of the players that we got coming through, who were unknown players and then went on to become household names in the game in Australia, as we've just mentioned. And that was probably the good part to be involved with those sort of people. You still got friendships with the likes of Trimboli and Markowski, and these are actual legends of the game.
Back then, Sunshine George Cross was a big club. They still, you know, they were a huge club. Mm. Ernie Merrick had some time there as well as
yeah,
a coach.
Yeah, Ernie was there. Yeah. I think Ernie got rid of me. So.
Okay, we'll leave it on that one, guys. Right, so, and they used to play, there was a big footy ground there as well. They used to do some training.
Yeah, Skinner Reserve.
Skinner Reserve through there. So I remember going there years and years ago because I had a loan spell there with Musket and the rest of the boys with Kenny Wagstaff.
What a lot of people don't appreciate about Deputy Doug is that despite his austere appearance and, you know, his very, very fatherly kind of, very mature attitude, one might even say, he's actually got a bit of a reputation amongst the old guard for being a complete dick. And Chris,
and to be fair, Dean Hennessy touched on it a bit last in the last show, and apparently I was a complete dick.
And Chris Taylor managed to expand on that before the show. But I've got a call on you, Chrissy, to tell us the story of the first time you crossed paths with Deputy Doug.
Well, Deputy, I didn't even know him at the time, but at the end of my...
Make sure you get the story right, because we know they're crossing paths here. I can't remember it, but apparently...
At the end of my playing career, I left George Cross and went...
150 National League game CT. Yeah.
Ken Murphy out down at Thomastown. So I had a year at Thomastown. And in one game, we played Frankston Pines. I think we were 3-0 up at the time. And
I was angry.
This kid came on, a young kid, and running around like a headless chuck. And all of a sudden got a little bit verbal, a couple of nutmegs and that. And he's leaving the boat.
Angry,
yeah. And, so got a little bit verbal. And
Could you imagine?
The exact words he said to me, do you know who I am?
And who was I?
No.
It said
no,
me, but I'm angry again.
Tell me the story. I'm a kickboxer. I'm this, I'm that. You know, I spar with Dave Hedgecock.
I worked for Dave for a while.
Well, Dave was a kickboxing
He was a guru. And he still does the... he's still done the... while back now, though.
Yeah.
He's the referee.
So the comments
Stand the
were,
man and the rest of them.
I'm best mates with Dave Hedgecock. And I said, oh, yeah, that's Alfred's brother, isn't it? And Doug is sharp as a tack. No, he hasn't got a brother.
He actually has. Mick. He's the run the mill. So could you imagine a 17-year-old kid just getting rifled? Now, actually, it would have been about 80, which is even probably worse.
Honestly, you know, I have a rich background, and had I been there that day, that would have been delibly etched. You know, in the modern generation, we would have had that on YouTube by now.
And if I'm red now, I am embarrassed. Because going back, it's funny, we were talking about it before, is that was me as a player, I actually kept that close. I never wind people up or get involved.
Apparently,
not until they get the ball.
Apparently, it took you the likes of Chris Taylor to learn you your lessons.
Maybe that's
Deputy
where
Doug.
I learned.
We've got to take a break on the locker room on what is turning out to be a very invigorating Tuesday. Even a couple of shows to go for the season. Thanks again for your support. We'll catch you after the break. Chris Taylor's going to stay with us and talk about the state of the game.
Lock, stock and two smoking barrels. I'd have to say Kasabian. Oh, probably steak and chips. Probably Matt Thomas, otherwise Teletubby. Look, it's probably the most rewarding time I've had at any club in the time I've had there so far. Asking a hard question now, aren't you? It's a love-hate relationship, let's put it that way.
And welcome back to the locker room on this wonderful Tuesday evening here at the Springthorpe Country Club. We're in the VIP room. We thank them for all their support and their help. And don't forget our seemingly endless quest to find out what has become of Len McKendry. We are on Len McKendry watch So if you're out there, Lenny, we're coming looking for you. We're going to get you back and we're going to get you on the show because you are a legend of the game. Speaking of legends of the game, we've got Chris Taylor, who's currently coaching South Melbourne, of course, in the Victorian Premier League, but he has quite a history in the NSL, and something we love to do when we're talking to staffs in the past. And Chris, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say you were one of the staffs in the past, and you're a very handsome young man as well. And you did some radio. Do you remember doing radio together?
Yeah, yeah.
We were so awesome.
Grand final, Carlton and
South Melbourne. And we, as a team, I feel we gelled much better than Doug and I do. But that, I'm just putting it out there, folks.
A lot of love. A lot of love mission. I've been slaughtered twice. One more and they're both going out the window.
Chris,
sideways.
Oh, that's right, because you're a kickboxer. Chrissy, quickly, just looking back on your career. One thing we always like to do when we're reminiscing is to talk about, if you could have one moment back as a player, just one glistening moment that you remember so fondly and you think, you know how we all do it when we're old and go, I wish I could do that again. Like, for example, when I was with a supermodel one night, that never happened. But in my head it did. Which moment, which of your playing career would you grab back in a heartbeat just to relive?
Look, I really enjoyed playing down at Olympic Park, the old Olympic Park, you know, and we used to have double headers down there. I think it was the Buffalo Cup. And
Doherty.
I think one game we played down there in front of something like 24,000 people, and, you know, and that was a buzz in them days, and beautiful ground and that. So they're the memories I've got of playing, you know, that I thought were very, very good. Yeah.
Best player that you played with and against? And it was really interesting because before the show, Chris was reeling off the number of quality opponents in the NSL that used to skin you alive, quite frankly.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
But who just stands out and you go, my God, that player, he could play?
Well, I probably had three. I'll probably narrow it down to three that I thought were exceptional. I played against Stosic, who played for Footscray.
Vlado Stosic, yep.
And people talk about quality players nowadays. I mean, the boy went back 2 years later to play man of the match in a European Cup final. So
held his own.
It was good. It was very, very good. Jackoff was probably the best player consistently over here for a period of time. You know, even playing against him, you're in awe of some of the tricks he could do and the qualities he had. You'd pay money today to go and watch players like that. And Selko Azic, who played at
Melbourne Croatia.
Yep. Wonderful player, you know, and they were the quality of players that, you know, you looked at and thought, the league was good in them days, in my opinion.
Oh, absolutely.
A lot of good players around, you know, that went through the system, but they were probably my three points, yeah.
And, Chrissy, we're going to talk about your coaching career because it's been fairly extensive since you retired from playing. But just quickly, which was the coach, now that you're coaching yourself, which was the coach you look back on and you think that mentor was the person that really, really affected, you know, the direction my career went?
Well, I mean, I never had a great deal of coaches, so you'd have to say John Gardner. I mean, he's the one that took me on coaching courses, made me go to coaching courses as a player, and I think he was my coach for something like 7 years, so he obviously had a big impact and very, very good coach, and anyone that's played under him holds him in very high regard. So
very well respected.
Yeah, very well without respected. Doubt, you know, and I've got a lot of time for him, yeah.
Speaking of which, though, mate, you know, we're going to go back and say, well, you know, people that don't know, you actually, as a kid, played alongside someone like Gary Lineker, a UK legend of the game.
Yeah.
Four or five years with Gary, he scored 130 goals.
Yeah, I'd like to think he learnt a lot from me, you know. Someone that never scored a goal, you know. So, but I grew up with him and we played him about four or five age groups together, and he did all right, actually.
He's done all right. He's done okay at the game, right? So he spent time at Leicester as a schoolboy.
Yep.
And got to the UK, got to Australia, played here, 150 National League games, done quite well. Hip injury slowed you right down.
Well, it didn't do me much good, did it?
You're still moving. You've had a couple of hip operations, obviously, the last few years.
Yeah, and I'm faster now than when I played.
You still get around. But, mate, 208. 2012,
yep.
VPL Coach of the Year.
Yep.
Yep. Been at Green Gully, you've been at Altona East, Sunshine George Cross, South Melbourne, Dandy Thunder.
Melbourne Knights.
And Melbourne Knights.
Yep.
Fair record. Out of them clubs, which one would you say, obviously, what's the most memorable club? I know they've all touched you in different ways. What would be the most memorable one?
Well, it's hard to say because I think they've all got, you know, had a big impact on me. I mean, Green Gully gave me the opportunity in the first place, and, you know, I'm forever grateful to that. But I had a good time at Sunshine, as both as a player and a coach. Altona East was, you know, they were good times there, you know, probably more stories at that club than anywhere else.
We might throw one in later, Blakey.
That we can't talk about. But, that you know, that they were probably similar to what Northcote are today, very close-knit club and good social side of it. But, you know, Danny Nong was phenomenal.
Well, last year, you won the Cup, the Minor Cup, and you've actually won the league. It's not a bad trifecta, mate.
No. I mean, that's, you know, you couldn't have asked for any more, you know, and, you know, good people there. And but then you move on, and, you know, I'm probably at a club that, you know, is the envy of most clubs around, and got such a rich history and that sort of thing.
It is a big club.
Chris Taylor is our special guest tonight on Locker Room. Does beckon the question, Dougie, and we've had this discourse a few times about the amount of coaching talent and possibly playing talent too that does a lot of time in the lower competitions. But there's almost a closed door policy when it comes to, because there's so limited the opportunities now. With
talking
the
about A-League. The A-League. Yeah, yeah. It's only like we, Chris and I were speaking before. You know, you went for a job, were you an application 2008 or 2009? I think you there was a job applicant at Melbourne Heart.
Oh, look, yeah, I suppose I threw my hat in the ring with everyone else for an assistant role, but, you know, that's... I think the hard thing at the moment is, you know, in the A-League, it's really about personalities and profiles that fit.
And we've got some breaking news coming from us. I've got a little bit of news from the whispers of the UK, which we can bring that into play.
Keep your irons in the fire, Dougie. We're going to be back after the break, and we're also going to... get some legal action happening so Chris can get his hat back from Melbourne Heart. We'll see you after the break. Welcome back to Tuesday Night. We are having such a pleasant time on the couch with Chrissy Taylor. Unexpectedly good time. I'm aroused in ways you'll never understand, as I am always when I'm in the presence of the great man, Jay Fott. Jay Fott joins us on the couch now.
Great to be here, Blakey and Dougie, and it's wonderful to be here with the legend of the game, CT.
Mate, we're going to go into Jay Paul. We're going to come back to you in a second. CT, we're talking about the A-League a minute ago, mate, and talking about some coaches that are involved. And the gossip in the news is from the UK that the Duca is currently in the UK doing some coaching, some badges. So it'll be interesting to see if he wanders back onto the shores and pops up somewhere. How does it feel as a coach that's gone through, and let's talk about before, we'll go back to it and say, well, how many players you've been involved with that have gone on in Australia or overseas? You know, just reel a few names off, please, mate.
Whether it's the players, I mean, the proud thing I've got is introducing them into senior level. I mean, Pantelidis played at 15, 16 at Altona East. Ivan Franich, I had at Melbourne Knights, who's now playing for Australia, as a 16, 17-year-old, converted into a fullback. Deganzic at 16. Manny Muscat, 16. Captain at 17 at George Cross. Cameron Watson, you know, so... And the list is quite extensive, but the pleasing part for me is you actually introduce them into senior football. That now they go on and play in the A-League, and that's, you know, that's
rewarding, isn't it? Yeah, as a coach being there with you, you actually is quite rewarding. But you wonder, guys, what I'm trying to say is, if you look around the coaches that are involved in the A-League, they've all played for the country. We can see what the marketing, what they're trying to do, but is there a place for someone like Chris Taylor that has been involved in the game, who has basically... Under 15s, you've been involved with the Victorian team, you've run us up in the Australian Championships, you know. Is there a place for someone like CT? I think there should be in youth development or even at an assistant level. And that's what the game's missing, I believe, in, mate.
Well, look, it's hard to say, you know, and being objective to the whole thing, but then we do produce good coaches. Look at the likes of Ange and Graham Arnold, two quality coaches that could hold their own in Europe. So... you know, there's a positive to it as well, you know, and they're people who have been around for a while, so, you know, they've done the hard yards.
And they've got Muscat now, to be fair, and you give Kev where he's due, you know, he's been an assistant all his time, and he's learned his apprenticeship, and it's his opportunity now, I suppose.
And in Kev's defence, he's done all the badges, he's worked hard to get to where he has, and he's a great personality, and that's what I think is a big thing with the coaches. You want people who are going to be there And, you know, he presents himself well. He's very good for victory, and he's a good front man, so I think it's a good choice.
So stay tuned. I'd like to see CT somewhere involved in the FFA, so I'm going to throw it at you. Now, J-Pod, come on, mate. What's been going on, buddy, in the news?
Big news in the NPL situation here in Victoria. Basically, the parties, the clubs and the FFA met and actually at the direction of the FFA. So the FFA's come in on top of this, and basically the talks have fallen down again. So basically the FFV have said now they're not going to have an NPL in 2014. So that's not going to happen, apparently.
Is that confirmed?
Well, according to FFV, it is. So I don't know. I was going to ask Chris, I mean, where do you sit in all of this? How do you see it all? Because I think Victoria's becoming a bit of a laughingstock in football with this fiasco with the NPLV.
On the mic, boy, mate, today. I've been promoted.
Yeah. Well, look, there's definitely got to be some sort of direction. I mean, it's difficult. You know, the clubs are the history of the game, and they've been there for so long. The Federation, in my opinion, needs to pull the finger out a little bit and give the game some sort of direction, because it's only, you know, working against the younger kids that are coming through, and that's the pathway that they're talking about creating. But we've always created good players. You know, you go back to the late 80s and 90s, and Victoria were a superpower at youth level. We don't do that anymore. So we're doing something wrong. You know, there needs to be a clear direction on the way we want to go forward.
I actually, and you tell me wrong or right here, I actually go back to when we were playing, we had seniors, reserves, youth, under 16, under 18, under 16. The pathway got stopped at 15 to reserves when they brought it in. Reserve players was under 21. So I actually believe 15 to 18 to 19, we lost a lot of players to other sports and there was no direction for them. Is it coming back? Can you see it coming back?
Well, look, at one stage you had Super Leagues, you had regionals, you had state teams, and the cream always went to the top. I think we're diluting it a little bit at the moment.
And you can't say the game's not blemished at the moment, because there's more people, the rumours have it, there's more people playing soccer in Australia than the other sports. So they're obviously there, grassroots is there.
Well, definitely there, but I just think when you dilute the game, you're not creating the best. The best have to play against the best, and if that's not happening, then you're not going to create a good standard of competition. The competition's measured by the best team in the league, not the weakest.
So what happens now to CT? Did you know about, obviously you didn't know that news, that it's been called off, or did you know?
I mean, there's an ongoing legal battle, and we all know what's going on there, but, you know, there needs to be a clear direction from the people above. That's what they're running the game for, and at the moment...
Here's the weird thing. You've got the FFV claiming that just two zone representatives are basically riling against them, and that's what's causing the NPL to be delayed. And the clubs are coming back saying, well, it's not just two zone reps, it's actually 64 co-signatory clubs. So it's not just, you know, just two little zone reps that are throwing a spanner in all the works. It's actually become a big bun fight, as we've talked about before, Dougie, between all the clubs, pretty much, in the Premier League, most of the state league clubs, against the FFV, which is appearing to be now intransigent. So they're not, I sort of concur with Chris, they sort of seem to be stuck in the one place and not willing to move at all.
The hardest thing, I suppose, Chris, for someone like yourself and being involved in coaching before, where do you get your preparation? You know, when does the season start? Do we know when the season starts in the Victorian Premier League? Or is it still up in the air? Or?
We don't know what league there is next year, so...
According to the FFV's latest release, it's as we were this year.
So basically,
BPL go, we don't know how many teams or whatever, but it's as we were.
So South Melbourne, you'll be starting your pre-season tonight then, mate?
Yeah, we're up for a kickboxer if you're available.
I've found one, Blakey. We've got him out of his chair, he'll be okay. So now, is that the rest of the news, Jay Potter?
We'll elaborate in further episodes, I reckon, because there's a lot more to talk about.
Chris Taylor, thank you very much for coming in, mate. It's been a great pleasure. Jay Pod, guys, Dougie's shirt, this is the Burnley one, basically war.
Oh, they're on top of the league.
They're on top of the league, I was tied. On top of the league in the championship. I got to wear this one game, and I actually took it to the hospital. And I actually thought, well, I'll keep it, because I smashed my cheekbone in four places. Sean Murphy comes up to me and goes, how many fingers have I got up? And I looked at him and went, three. I can actually see him. My mouth was down here. I smashed in four places. Spent the night in hospital. Thought, well, I might as well bring this one home. And I was disappointed because I was on $250,000 move.
Was this before or after he kickboxed you?
No, he headbutted me. He won. I was down and out. I had shot it off. He got me under the chin, back header. So, guys, Channel 31, you're hearing it live. Great news. Coming back to you next week, Tuesday.
7 p.m. Don't be scared.
Dougie's had his moment in the sun. He's wanted to wrap up a show a week. Great job, Dougie, Jay Fott, Chris Taylor. Thanks so much. Catch you next week.